really nervous about this today. I mean, not in a bad way, but just like we haven't seen each other and been in this space talking about the thing that we did.
It's like a real high school reunion. Amazing moments, sad moments, horrific moments.
I love these people, and there's just no getting around it, because I've tried. It'd be a lot easier sometimes to just write them out and they're gone. But that's not the experience that we had, and it's not the way we feel about each other.
For 10 years, the cast of Beverly Hills 90210 captured the hearts of fans around the world. It was a decade of amazing popularity and intense controversy. And tonight, for the first time, the cast comes together to revisit the past and set the record straight. On Beverly Hills 90210, The Reunion.
First day of school, strange city, no house, no friends. I'm psyched.
I had no expectations, personally. Did any of us really think that it was going to become what it became, that we would be running down the streets of London, like, you know, with fans chasing after us?
Mom, let's go shopping today, and I'll go to school tomorrow. First impressions are incredibly important.
Honey, you can make a wonderful first impression.
Everybody here looks like they just stepped out of a music video. I don't even have the right hair.
Actually, in the beginning, I thought the pilot, I didn't like the pilot at all, and I actually looked for a hostess in Toronto because I thought the show was never going to air after I saw the pilot.
So she obviously had no
I had no expectations.
I think we're going to need a raise in our allowance.
And I think 90210 came along at a point where, you know, young adults of America were really ready for it.
Something's wrong, Colin. This stuff tastes weird. I'm not getting a buzz at all.
I think that our show it was the first show that ever took young people's issues seriously and kind of cracked them open, whether they were pretty or ugly, that we got to show them.
You have to recognize that you have a serious problem.
Kel, I'm not a drug addict.
You may not think so, but your body disagrees.
We dealt with issues that were really pertinent in every society, no matter what language people were talking or what skin color they were.
We had hot chicks.
The young adults of the
other shows didn't have the chicks.
Right.
We had hot chicks.
Man, being so eloquent and like well spoken, and you just had to throw that in.
I knew where he was going with that. We did all those things.
That was the subtext that I've always operated on.
But, you know, we were at the beach, man. We had hot chicks and bikinis. And it was good. I like shooting at the beach.
You liked all the hot chicks who would come up to you when the cameras were off.
When we lived at the beach, that was the best time.
I can't believe I'm getting paid for this.
Oh, if we don't find a couple honeys in this bunch, we are losers.
Huge.
Remember the time we were playing tug of war and my boob came out?
I missed that.
A lot from each other. There was no, you know, no big secrets.
My biggest challenge was trying to pretend that Jason was my brother. That was my biggest challenge, because from day one I was like, he is so hot. And I was just like, what do I do?
You know, for a sister, you're not half bad.
Well, don't you ever forget it.
Well, that was one storyline that they missed, huh?
Now I'm playing on the incest channel.
They'd have to do that in the reunion.
No,
reunion
I think
show.
There were like a couple of people that would like call me, and I hear it more now that we're always like, there's some sort of weird incestual like thing between
totally.
You and Brandon. I'm like, uh-huh, you better believe it.
Hi.
Hi.
That was by far my biggest challenge of doing that show.
Yeah, we did a lot of groping. You look at the pictures of us all back then, and you know, I have this one picture. I'm standing there, and I got my hand on Shannon. Tori has her hand in my pocket. Jay's got his arm over Shannon, going to Jenny like this. Ian's hands coming down inside on Gab. You know, we're all these pictures of us just groping each other.
Well, you know, you start doing these making out scenes and they don't call cut, so your hands start going. They just start doing their job. And they would say, guys, this is, you know, 8 o'clock. You can't be grabbing it. And they would say to Shannon, you can't reach down there. And all right, you know, and then we'd, every time somebody's hand would go below the frame, they'd be like, cut. It looks like you're grabbing her. Well, I am grabbing her. Just don't shoot it.
Great tactile cast.
We were a very tactile cast, right. And we found
comfort in each other.
Yeah, we would just grab on.
Body parts?
We took comfort in the body parts of one another.
Do you want to expand on that, Shannon?
No.
Do you want to expand on your body parts?
No, I do not.
Are you sure?
We can expand on yours, though.
Right.
So, guys, what do you think? Methinks thou art style.
I think that, you know, the fashion on the show was like dictated by the fashion of the time, wasn't it?
Definitely. The 80s.
I mean, certainly for you, I mean, you guys were much more involved.
I mean, there were definitely some times when you looked and you were like, yes. What? Well, all of us.
Best dress is kind of a hard thing. I think best dress is like the most fashion forward. I kind of think
Donna.
Tori, yeah, I think Donna, because she took the most risk with her fashion and was always like sort of pushing it.
You know, she's got that heart shape going on,
and she just looked good in clothes.
She wants a young American.
And although sometimes there was a few mistakes
got that
in
bar.
There.
Oh, how embarrassing.
And I got one damn song that can make me break down and cry.
Guys, oh, help, please, can someone help me? Oh, God. Thank you.
A dress is a dance, don't.
I remember a photo shoot where all of you wanted to wear a red dress.
Big fight about the red dress.
Well, you'll just have to go change.
No, you're going to have to go change.
Brenda, I am a spring princess. Callie, I don't give a damn.
And we're like out there for an hour in the sun, sweat.
Jason,
and I turn to Jay, I'm like, what the hell is going on? Well, she wants to wear a red dress, but the other one's wearing a red dress. And I said to wardrobe, bring me a red dress.
We all wanted the red dress at that point.
After that, I wanted a picture. Yes, I wanted a picture of the whole cast in a red dress. Then it would be settled and it would be good. And that would, you talk about a photo, you in a red dress, bro, I could sell that.
You got a couple of pictures of
I want more dresses on that show than either of you guys.
Don't say anything.
You look beautiful.
Coming up, Luke Perry reveals the painful truth behind the 90210 romances.
Jenny and I used to send each other to the hospital on a fairly regular basis.
The secret that Ian and Shannon tried to keep from the 90210 producers.
I think that you were that much of a stand-up guy that you did not rat me out.
And the cast recalls one of their all-time favorite episodes. All when Beverly Hills 90210, The Reunion, continues.
Matt, it's me here. Brandon Walsh, honors English, never been late for work. Boy Scout.
Brandon, in a lot of ways, was the social conscience of America. And, you know, he was a very straight arrow.
You're not fine. I'm fine. People who get high and play with guns are not fine.
For me, you know, being in my 20s and growing up in Hollywood, it was good to have a friend, I consider Brandon a friend, that was such a straight arrow, because I think he kept me out of trouble a lot of times, which was a very good thing.
I'm not in the best of moods. I was up all night studying.
I was too.
What, making cheat notes?
Crossed my mind. But if I cheated, I might screw up the curve for this friend of mine, who I care about and respect more than she knows. Even if she can be a royal pain.
You know, I think Brandon was a good influence on Jason in a lot of ways, because he was, you know, a very thoughtful, a very conscientious guy. And I think that, you know, having him be part of my life was good for me.
Jenny and I used to send each other to the hospital on a fairly regular basis, and this is off camera. I wanted to mention that. I ran her over with a jet ski once. I hit her in the head, knocked her unconscious. Woo-hoo!
Yeah! You okay?
She was out in the water. Bodyguard dove in, fished around, pulled Jenny up like a drowned cat. Paramedics came, the whole deal. She sprayed Benaca in my eye one time.
Hey, how am I doing?
Audrey in motion.
I have a little control problem.
What?
Different bumps and bruises. I knocked her down. Again, somebody had to go to the emergency room. Shannon and I were doing a scene at the beach one time, and we were simulating the From Here to Eternity thing.
Oh, yeah.
And we had these big rocks set up stage.
And trying to kiss each other with all sand in the mouth.
Yeah, sand in the mouth and the kissing. So we're laying there, and we're macking, and then I look up, and something bumps me, and it's one of the rocks. And the set is floating away around us as we're trying to do this thing. And Shannon's laughing, so I roll her over on top of me. And she's on top of me, and I just see this giant wave coming behind her, and I'm like, Shan. And we both just got wiped out. You remember that?
Yes.
Pieces of bathing suit. It was good.
That was good.
And Jenny and I were in a swimming pool on top of the Bellage Hotel, and we were supposed to be swimming and talking and kissing. And I remember us being in the swimming pool, and all the crew had on winter coats. So what I was doing was trying to hold her close to me and stay, you know, really warm. And,
what do you say?
I'm just saying that I'm warmer when you're close to me than I am when you're not.
Don't do that if you don't mean it.
I mean it.
Well, you're in trouble now.
And, teeth were chattering so hard, she bit my lip and I was bleeding. That's what I remember, the challenge of trying to say that dialogue and kiss that girl and spin and just freezing the whole time.
Episode 14, it was the episode, I think it was called Slumber Party. Jen, you had this monologue where you were...
She was weeping.
Where you were, you know, conveying to everybody what had happened to you, yeah. And, you know, the camera was moving in, and I was so moved by your performance.
Kelly, what was your first sexual experience?
All right. I'll tell you. Ross Weber was this godly stud on the football team who I had a hopeless crush on in the ninth grade.
I remember, and you know what? And it made us cry. And we were sitting in a circle, and all the girls were, I remember.
We were all crying revealing. Just by watching her.
And one night after some game, everybody was getting drunk except me. And a bunch of us drove up to Mulholland. When we got there, Ross says he wants to take me to his favorite spot in the woods. So stupid. I think, wow, that would be a neat thing to do. But of course, when we get there, all he wants to do is have sex. He kept saying, come on, Kel. I know you want it. I know you want it, Kelly. And I did. But not on the ground.
didn't even bring a blanket. It was over pretty quick, and after that he took me home. And never talked to me again.
I was so affected by your performance that I said, wow, Jenny, it was mm-hmm. so powerful. When that show finished, I said, oh, man. You know, when you can watch TV and you can laugh and you can cry, but when you get moved, when you mm-hmm. when like there's goosebumps, that was like, I think, the first time, Jenny.
That you really realized.
That I said, oh, my God.
That you could remember the number, the episode number.
You know,
episode 14, you
well, made
me cry,
wait a second.
Jen.
That was also the episode that Steve's Corvette got stolen.
Steve, I don't think they're coming back.
Brent, shut up.
The number of me getting you in trouble with the transpo department.
Oh, Shannon.
It was...
I used to be able to drive the Corvette around. I'll take it back to set.
Ian always got to drive it around, and we were in
Which
Altadena filming.
Which was the hugest perk for me.
Nice car. Well, you got to have something to live for, right?
And all I had was, like my Jeep, and I wanted a fast car so bad.
Ian,
so
I was
like, Ian, let me drive it with you.
No, Shannon, no. They don't... No, no.
But he let me...
Okay.
And you were laughing in the car ride. You were having a pretty good time.
Well, because I couldn't believe you're like doing 60 miles an hour on these surface streets that have dips.
I bottomed out.
She bottomed out. Cracks the oil pan. I get back. The car's smoking.
You're rough on the oil pan.
I never got to drive that Corvette again.
And I was like, it was Ian. It was Ian.
From that day on, I maybe put a mile on.
If I recall correctly, I think that you were that much of a stand-up guy that you did not rat me out.
Dude.
But he's a man. He can, and he was like, don't worry about it.
Hop in. All right. Welcome to West Beverly High.
Coming up, the X-rated activities right next door to the 90210 stage.
We go over there.
You guys told me you went to the candy store.
Well.
The real stories behind the glamorous 90210 look.
Oh, what was I thinking? Wasn't there any mirror? What?
And Shannon finally reveals the truth behind one of her most impetuous decisions.
When I came on set, people's mouths dropped. They were like...
All when Beverly Hills 90210, the reunion continues.
The wonderful thing about doing a TV show is that you're on this terrific lot at like a studio, and you have a commissary, and you know, you get to bump into people like George Clooney, and you know, like it's such a social, cool little atmosphere, and you see all these big movie stars, and you're like, ah, he's hot, and you know, like, look at that, you know. It's a wild experience, and instead, we were in this crappy warehouse. So it was really interesting because we were very isolated. You know, once we drove to that set and that warehouse in Van Nuys, we saw each other, and that was it.
Yeah, the warehouses were kind of a singular experience, weren't they?
I thought, wow, we hit it big. This is glamorous.
Yeah.
It was a warehouse.
And there was no sound.
Right. No sound.
Right.
And rats.
It's still like that.
Next to the Taco Rio.
Yeah. The one thing I remember, you know,
must
we
be
were
lunch.
Like third season, and we still all had the smallest dressing rooms in the world. Remember?
Yeah.
We had the honey wagons. Everybody had a dressing room about the size of this coffee table. People would come to the show. All this press would come to the show. And they'd be like, oh, this is your dressing room? And we're like, yeah, it's glamorous. Come on in. No, all of you. Come on in. Squeeze in.
And it kept growing. Like, originally we had, like, two warehouses. Right. Then it became three. And then
we had the whole
across the alley. And then we were,
right next to the porn shop.
Right. Yeah. We shared a common wall with one of the largest distributors of pornography in the valley. Yeah. And I remember times we'd be doing scenes, and you could just hear, ka-chunk, 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 ka-chunk.
Hey, where's Brian?
Yeah.
Brian?
And they would just be over there duplicating.
And he's next door filling up a bag of goodies.
Really
so one day we went over. We wanted to see what was going on. We go over there.
You guys told me you went to the candy store.
Well.
And
it
was candy store.
We went over there, and they had just these huge duplicating 18, bags.
18,000 video recorders.
Did you go there, Jen?
It was crazy.
No.
It was crazy.
No.
They were especially proud of one title that they had. It was called 90210.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, I still see shows that I've never seen before on the reruns, and it's always... Oh, what was I thinking? Wasn't there a mirror? What? I don't remember anybody saying, hey, yo, Z, you might want to undo a button or three.
I want you to hear how Kelly disses my new girlfriend and pretends it's for my own good.
Sounds kind of nauseating if you ask me.
Okay, did anybody tell me to, like, pluck my eyebrows in the beginning? They could have done that for me, too. We all, like, went through that, you know?
The thing was, you only had one at the beginning. And we thought, shit, eyebrow, make it two.
It's astonishing. Oh. The hairdos, the...
Yeah.
I mean, what?
You're
what's
not
going
in anymore?
On?
Freeze frame. Freeze frame. Freeze frame.
You had a mullet going.
Had a mullet? Can you play hockey?
Dude, come on. It was the 80s, man. Well, okay, it was 1990, 90s. But it was the 80s.
I remember, Jason, you said you'd never change your hair on the whole show because you didn't want to, like, change Brandon.
Yeah, I tried to remain pretty consistent throughout.
I think you have a hair out of place over there.
Really?
And I just had a trimmed down version of the flock of seagulls. That's all I did was trim that back.
Watch out, man. You're flirting with bad karma. Be careful.
And your hair just kept getting higher.
I know.
I used to, for a while, I had to have Brian would help me do it. Oh, my hair was so long. It's so big. I'd blow it up with a hair dryer, and Brian would stand underneath with a little piece of scaffolding and then get a bottle of hairspray and just...
How about your sideburns? Oh. You guys with the sideburns going down your jaw.
It was not really impressive.
It was
work,
a sideburn contest between the two of you guys.
That's right. We had a contest.
And people would copy you. Oh, that's the funny thing.
Not people. Me. I realized my sideburns were getting longer.
They were
longer.
Down to, like, and I go out on the street. People would have, like, the guys on the 90210 sideburns.
Unbelievable. You know, it was a race between my sideburns and the hair on the back of my neck, which could get longer. Ridiculous.
And it was the neck by a neck.
It was by a neck, for sure.
How about when they used to go and cut so you could see on your eyebrow your scar?
My scar.
Yeah.
Because the doll they made of me that looks like Joe Pesci actually has a scar through its eye. The Dylan action figure. We were less than thrilled when we were told after the fact that we were going to be made into action figures.
They weren't action figures.
They were
action
figures.
Mine's an action figure.
What a fantasy. Maybe that's how you play
with
it.
That's what you want to say.
Yeah. Well, yeah, mine's an action figure.
I
you guys can be
great.
Barbie dolls.
Man, my goddaughter like undresses like me all the time. She's like, look at Shay, you're naked. I'm like, great. You know, like, that's my body. I mean, you know, it's perfection. I wish it was, but still, it's like...
But you realize somewhere there's a factory where they'll just pop your head off and put somebody else's on.
Undressing you and playing with your doll. And
yeah.
It's a little scary.
Yeah.
The hair always was sort of like a big deal in 90210. You know, we weren't really allowed to change our hair. And I get bored easily. I get bored just with everything in my life, but especially my hair. And I'll start cutting it and chopping into it. And I walked on the set one day, and my hair had been down to here, and I had cut it off to here. People's mouths dropped. They were like, oh, what did you do? And I went, now I just told him to trim it. I don't know what happened. That was my excuse.
Coming up, 90210's popularity puts the cast in danger.
Fidel Castro got a satellite dish because he had a crush on Jen.
Shannon's most embarrassing on-screen moment.
Oh, my God.
And it was by far one of the most humiliating moments for me personally.
And the cast reveals their choice for most likely to succeed. All in Beverly Hills 90210, The Reunion returns.
Thousands of teens showed up to see Jenny Garth, who plays Kelly Taylor on the hit TV series Beverly Hills 90210. Garth was scheduled to sign autographs, but was escorted out of the mall because the crowd refused to back away from the stage after requests were made over the loudspeaker.
We started getting fan mail from countries that I still haven't been to.
Prison? Yeah. You've prisons? Still
I got a letter from a man in India who said he was my father and that I should have a DNA.
There you go.
Oh, my goodness.
Isn't that funny?
Oh, yeah, I remember Jay coming back saying, I've been asked to leave some of the finest restaurants in Paris. I had such a good trip. We got to the point where we go into places. Remember that? They come up and they said, Mr. Priestley, yes, would you please leave? And he said, why is that? And look outside, and there'd be like 1,000 people jammed outside the restaurant, and Jay couldn't get out. So they would ask us to leave and take you out the back or whatever.
Brian and I went to Spain. Anything. And as soon as the doors opened on the plane, the military came in, pointed to us, and said, come on. I didn't know what was going on.
Midnight Express.
Yeah. So we get off the plane. Is there a problem? What's going on here? Well, the problem was there was like 15,000 people at the airport. The talk show that we had gone to be on, let them know, let the public know when we were riding, what plane we were going to be on. And it was just, it was amazing.
We're sitting at Chasen's. Ron Reagan walks up to the table. Sitting at the table at Chasen's.
That's right.
President Reagan comes up to the table. Jay and I are sitting there, and he's like, guys, how you doing? Things seem to be going well. Just walked on out. Jay and I are like, awesome. We were getting invited to the White House. You know, crazy stuff. Fidel Castro got a satellite dish because he had a crush on Jen. So he could watch it, you know, out of my... He's like, ooh, blonde American girl.
Hot baby.
Yeah.
Yeah, me too. But
I think
still.
The amazing thing, though, about the fans of 90210 is they've been unbelievably loyal to all of us.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah,
over the years and with everything that we move on to and just in our career in general, they are the most loyal fans, I think, that you can get. And
people still
extremely lucky.
Hey, how you doing? Brendan Walsh. Damn glad to meet you. Hi, Brendan Walsh. And yes.
No, I thought the character that was most going to succeed was probably Brandon, actually, because I sort of thought he was going to go into politics and become, like, president.
You wouldn't happen to be Brandon Walsh, would you?
I used to be. Now I'm Brandon Walsh, the candidate, an entirely different person.
Everyone had their little niche to fulfill, and Brandon, of course, was the successful guy. Andrea was always the hardworking.
This is the top-ranked high school paper in the country, and I intend to keep it that way, so I suggest you put aside your dreams of editing the swimsuit issue of Sports Illustrated.
Wow, you are intense.
Dylan, you know, was the irreverent guy who didn't care and probably, you know, would be successful whether he had a trust fund or not.
I just don't believe in winning through intimidation. Plus, of course, I'm doing the intimidating.
Kelly always had her morals and high standards, and she was always going to do things without listening to anybody else.
We'll have a family. When we're ready.
I'm ready now, Brandon. I've given this a lot of thought, and I've decided to apply to be a foster parent to that baby.
I'm Brenda the doctor. Brenda was who knows?
It's very difficult for us to understand what's going on here.
What's going on is I didn't like my classes, I didn't like the dorm, I didn't like the people, I didn't like anything.
You just panicked.
Mom, you call it panic. I call it getting in touch with myself.
You know, Steve was always going to find the back door in.
How'd you get this? Bribery, larceny, grand theft. Your basic tools of the trade. But don't worry, we're not going to get caught.
Yeah, that's what every criminal says.
You know? But long as you got in, baby, it's okay.
Right. So I think, you know, to say who would be most successful, I think all the characters would have been, everybody found their own success.
Let's focus in on the fact that we're all young, free, healthy, wealthy, and wise, and about to embark on probably the most righteous journey of our lives thus far. Let's get busy.
Coming up, the cast decides on the most romantic 90210 moment.
Probably the most romantic moment on the show was you know, the shot heard around the world.
Plus, Shannon's education extends beyond West Beverly High.
My parents never really had, like, a conversation about sex with me, so, like, it was for real.
All when Beverly Hills 90210, The Reunion, returns.
Relax, okay? Meditate or something. I told you, I know what I'm doing.
There was this one episode where Brenda decided that she wanted to be blonde because she thought blondes got more attention, which me being a brunette, I naturally disagree with completely. She dyed her hair blonde and it went
all wrong.
Oh, my God. What happened?
I colored my hair.
And it was by far one of the most humiliating moments for me personally, because the wig was like just the ugliest orange in the world. And it was out here and just like frizzy and ugly. And I had to like be jogging with this big, huge wig on. And then Dylan pulls up.
Hi.
Hi.
I thought that was you, but didn't your hair used to be a little different?
Well, maybe just a little bit.
And they actually wanted me as Brenda to flirt with him. And I'm like, who the hell can flirt when your hair is out to here, it's orange? There's nothing remotely attractive about me at this moment.
Don't all you guys out here have a thing for blondes? I mean, that's what you told Kelly.
Blondes, brunettes, redheads, girls in tank tops.
I like your butt. I mean, your bike.
Oh, well, thank you.
It was pretty humiliating, and I was very happy that Brenda got to go back to having her natural dark hair.
For me, you know, probably the most romantic moment on the show was you know, the shot heard around the world when Brenda decided to give Dylan her virginity.
Dylan, this is so beautiful.
Yeah, I thought you'd like it.
Do you know why I'm so lucky?
Why?
How many girls get to have sex for the first time with someone they love?
I don't know. I've never really taken an opinion poll.
Mm. Dylan!
Woo!
Dylan, put me down!
I'm sorry. I just can't control myself.
Oh, don't fight it.
We are in the room.
We certainly are.
And the talk that Jim Walsh had with his daughter about having sex and, you know, Cindy chiming in.
For a moment there, I thought that maybe I was pregnant. My period was a few days late, so I got worried.
Well, did you do something that would give you reason to believe that if you were a few days late, that would indicate that you were pregnant?
You mean like sex?
Yes, something like that.
Yes, of course.
This actually embarrassed me. I mean, like,
I'm sure.
Me, not even Brenda.
Well,
I was humiliated
acting.
Doing that.
Like,
my parents never really had, like, a conversation about sex with me. So, like, it was for real.
So you got it on the show.
Big Jim.
It was humiliating.
Also, you know, the other big one is when Donna decided to get it on with David.
Well, I was going to say, I think that was the most romantic relationship because we got to see him puppy love.
David.
Oh, God, I'm sorry. I'm really sorry. I don't know what got into me.
They were babies.
Yeah,
almost like they could have skipped to school.
Donna, let me spend the night. How often are both your parents out of town?
No.
For me, it was always those two, because they were the youngest, and we got to see them go the farthest.
I've been thinking a lot about it.
And?
And I think we should wait till we're out of high school.
Wait, David.
What?
Donna, come on, what's taking so long?
You like your surprise?
How'd I get so lucky?
You waited.
Up, the entire Walsh family reunites for the very first time.
That's my boy!
And the bond that the cast will share forever.
We've been through life and death stuff, divorce, marriage, birth. We're still all together.
All when Beverly Hills 90210, The Reunion, returns.
Brenda?
No, Brenda couldn't make it. I'm LeVoyne. I'm taking a shift. Charmed, I'm sure.
Joey Tata just made us laugh nonstop. I mean, basically.
Yeah, it was pretty great with Joey.
He had an endless amount of energy.
Boundless
energy. You know
what?
He had great stories to tell. Forget just what he did on the show when we were off camera. The stories he would tell. He's been like.
Oh, Joey.
He was on Batman.
I saw him on Lost in Space.
I would always see him at the Playboy Mansion.
Hey, I'm charmed, I'm sure. I didn't miss it, did I?
Right on time.
Oh, have a piece of cake.
And Carol Potter, who played Mrs. Walsh, she cooked all the time. She made food for all of us so often.
The quintessential mother.
Oh,
she put Florence Henderson to shame.
Yeah. I think Jim and Cindy pretty much was.
They were the ideal.
They were the ideal
mother
parents.
And father.
Yeah. Oh, who are they? Ladies and gentlemen.
About us behind our backs.
Oh, ladies and
gentlemen.
Hey.
Oh, having fun. Sharon and I.
Oh my God, they have our pictures.
God, I
have a lot of
Remember
stuff
I had
to
hair?
Take home.
That's
with you,
that's a
pay stands.
This reunion was really, I was nervous this whole week about it. Not in a bad way, but just like we haven't seen each other and been in this space together. In this space, talking about the thing that we did. Were you nervous?
Not at all.
But it's kind of like the reunion kind of thing, and it was really, it's emotional because it's hard to say. I mean, I see Jenny having a new baby, and that's been a blessing. Yeah. And I think the hardest thing was Jason's accident was really.
That wasn't hard for me.
With you were at it.
But the odds that I had.
It was the aftermath that was hard.
Yeah, the aftermath was, yeah.
Everybody kept saying, he's getting better. And I'm going, I had these odds.
I've been making a buck off Jason again.
I mean, you know, we're making light of it, and we're sitting here, some of us, I mean, for whatever reasons, the people who couldn't be with us here today, and how much I'm so sad they're not here with us, mm-hmm. because
yeah. I wish they were here.
A yes. part of all of us being what we are, and I don't know, it's emotional. I mean, no matter what's gone on in our lives, this time and us being together when we shot the show was a very important time, and it is a family.
Definitely. 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 Definitely.
TV shows come and go. We've all been on them. We'll be on other ones. Different things happen. We've been through life and death stuff together. Divorce, marriage, birth. You know, we're still in the minds of a lot of other people, but most importantly in our own minds, we're still all together.
I think there's an incredible chemistry that's just kind of, that is always there between us. And I mean, I always know, and sometimes I'm on the outside of it, so I see it. And it's that's one of the things that was remarkable about the show is that it extended, it as we know, off the set, not always in a positive way, but it was incredible.
And that you just luck out, and you either get that or you don't.
Yeah.
But over time, we all came to care about each other, and you know we don't get on the phone every day and talk. But if something bad happens, we do. And if I need to talk to somebody at a difficult time, it will probably be somebody in this room.
Yeah, if we're always there for each other, I think that no matter what happens in life and no matter what obstacles we've had to overcome or, you know, personality conflicts, I think that we all know that we're, you know, family and some connected in some way forever.
Certainly, you know, you're hard-pressed ever be in a group this large and feel totally safe with everybody and feel protected and feel really good about everybody in the group, and I think that this one was really, really special, and almost more so than the work we did, just the personalities and what we all have and what we all feel for each other.
It continues to this day to be rewarding for the powers that be to bring us together. For me to feel so wonderful right now is another gift. Mm. So it's great to see you all.
You feeling good about that?
I feel great about
it. Dude, come here.
All right.